Welcome to the Spy Collection. My name is Anastasios and this time we have a rare artifact from an Italian company not so well known outside of the espionage world. Since 1993, in Torino, Italy, a company called BEA operates to develop spy gadgets for government agencies. Actually, until 2011 that WikiLeaks published their first leak of the Spy Files series, that company was completely in the shadows of the espionage world. Specifically, WikiLeaks released the company's 2008 product catalog, and among them, it had this one. The ENEA, part of the company's GSM audio surveillance product line. And this is the item we will look in today's video. In summary, there are three main categories of spy gadgets. The ones anyone can buy online are the simplest and, generally speaking, unsophisticated. Then the ones private investigators use are more expensive and significantly higher quality. Finally, we have items like this. Those are designed for government agencies, always striving to employ the most advanced and sophisticated spying capabilities, since they have to remain hidden from government-level counter-surveillance measures. BEA was producing that one as part of the ENEA series, a highly versatile, remotely operated, covert GSM audio surveillance device. Some of its important features were that it was small and robust, so that it can be concealed easily, that it had embedded anti-detection controls and was not emitting RF that is typically found on commercial listening devices. Since it was utilizing the GSM network, it had virtually unlimited range, basically anywhere where there was cellular network coverage. It supported two SIM cards for increased reliability, and we'll talk about this later. It could be configured to automatically enable or disable its operations with a variety of factors, such as motion detection, voice detection, digital input from the car it was installed in, and others. It had configurable listening timeout to ensure it's not always on. It required a security code to make any changes or access configuration parameters, and it had exceptional audio quality. Okay, enough with the specs, let's look at this. The catalog was from 2008, but this ENEA device here was from 2005. Here is the quick reference guide. You can find a scanned copy of this in the description below. As you can see, it's a pretty small device. This is the coaxial connection to install an antenna for improved coverage. Depending on where the operative was installing it, they could choose between a highly compact antenna, like this one, or an antenna like this, or even an antenna like this one. Of course, that was dependent on the operational needs. For instance, if this was to be installed on a motorcycle or on a house near a window, the small antenna would be fine. But if it was to be hidden deep inside a truck, a boat, or something else, you might need the added coverage of a larger antenna. To ensure theoretically unlimited lifetime, ENEA also came with this. What you see is a custom power cable with a fuse box. Of course, you can covertly install this to take power from a vehicle, a house, or anything else you might install this, or connect batteries to it. It has a proprietary connector, different from the rest, to avoid any human errors. And next to that, there are two more connectors. Those are for the sensors. The kit comes in with the dual microphone capsule, this one. Here you see the two microphones. Check how tiny those microphones were. Those were extremely high quality microphones and had enough cable length so that the surveillance technician could route them near the audio source. If we turn the device around, do you see this small hole right here? This is the light sensor. The ENEA also has a motion sensor, and it is configurable on when and how to activate with other means too. For instance, when it receives power, when it detects a voice, and so on. Let's open it up to see some more of its secrets. The first thing that probably you noticed is the dual SIM card. This was for many reasons. According to each manual, by inserting two different providers' SIM cards, you could have extended coverage from both networks. Also, you could dynamically decide which one to use, thus reducing the chance of detection. Finally, if anything happened to one of the SIM cards, such as getting blocked, deactivated, malfunction, or anything else, you didn't have to physically install a new SIM card since you already had a backup one in place. The second thing that some of you might have noticed is that all the microchips have their surface scratched. This is part of the low attribution features of the ENEA. Basically, it makes it near impossible to track back where the device was manufactured, by whom, and other details. A very important factor for spy agencies that is known as deniability. So, even if it gets discovered, even if there were indicators of who might have placed it, there could be no conclusive evidence, thus allowing the nation-state behind that operation to deny its involvement. To configure the device, there were three options. First, send SMS messages with a configured security code followed by SMS commands that configure how the ENEA will work. The second option was by calling the number of the primary SIM card, pressing the security code, and then pressing certain numbers. In this case, the DTMF tones were used to configure its settings. Lastly, BEA also offered a software called the ENEA Manager. This was using a US Robotics 56K modem to call the ENEA and send the configuration settings, meaning that the operator had a much more friendly user experience through the software, but practically the software was translating the user's actions back to DTMF commands as performed when calling the device to configure it. It is also worth noting that to avoid detection, ENEA had a built-in memory able to store over 18 hours of audio recordings. So the operator could configure it to record them and replay them on demand instead of calling back each time it's triggered. And that was the BEA ENEA GSM Covert Audio Listening Device from 2005, which from WikiLeaks we know that it was being sold to government agencies at least until 2008. If you have more information about it, please let us know in the comments below. Before we close, think about all the places that a device like that could have been concealed to spy on people, and also remember that this is a nearly 20-year-old technology. There might always be someone listening. Nothing is as it seems.